coming. This meeting, as I think you all know, has been called by our local chapter of Fairville, Canada, to discuss electoral reform and get the stand of local candidates. Fairville, Canada is a multi-partisan movement. As of today, we have 60,500 supporters from all walks of life and all points on the spectrum. Proportional representation is not a partisan issue. For example, Conservative Hugh Seeger is still a very vocal supporter of proportional representation, as he has been for years. Proportional representation means every vote will count equally. When every vote counts, voters won't have to worry about splitting the vote or casting a strategic vote, and more young voters will find it worthwhile voting. For the past several elections, at least 50% of all ballots cast across Canada did not count towards electing a representative. In 2011, 39.6% of votes somehow elected a government with a false majority, with 100% of power concentrated in the Prime Minister and his office. Opinion polls have shown at least 70% of Canadians support proportional representation. So we're going to start by seeing Professor Denis Pilon's 6-minute video on the Law Commission of Canada's recommended mixed member model of proportional representation.
On the right spot, let's start.
Associate Professor of Political Science at York University. Over the past decade, people interested in fixing our democracy have often asked just what would an alternative to our single-member, winner-take-all voting system actually look like? Right now, I want to introduce you to one of those concrete alternatives, the mixed-member proportional voting system. Some highly regarded democracies, Germany, New Zealand, Scotland, and many more, elect their representatives with mixed-member proportional, or MMP for short. MMP is a form of proportional representation, the most common approach to voting in the world. In fact, 85% of OECD countries use some form of proportional representation to elect their governments. So what is MMP? What does it look like? Basically, MMP combines our existing single-member, winner-take-all voting system with an element of proportional representation. The end result of using an MMP voting system is that the number of MPs elected to Parliament will match the share of votes cast for the different parties. Voters cast 39% of the votes for one party. That party will gain 39% of the seats, no more, no less. Let's look a little more closely at how an MMP system could be designed to be used in Canada. Here's a proposed electoral map for a Canadian MMP voting system. In this version, voters would elect 207 local MPs and an additional 131 regional MPs. These regional MPs would be elected from 27 top-up regions. The MMP system would not increase the size of our parliament. It would remain the same size at 338 MPs. Here's how the MMP system would work. The 207 local MPs would be elected just as our MPs are elected now. But at the same time that voters cast a vote for a local representative, they would also cast a vote for regional representation. These regional MPs would be used to top up the results to accurately reflect the popular vote for the different political parties. The top-up regions would have an average of 5 MPs, depending on the size of your top-up region. In a province with 14 MPs or fewer, the top-up region would be the whole province. This MMP model uses open lists so that all the MPs face the voters. By using an MMP voting system, most voters will be represented by a party they support, and they'll have the option of taking their issues to either their local MP or one of their regional MPs. Using MMP will change the dynamic of political competition, creating incentives for politicians to respond to what voters want. Let's explore the kind of results we might expect to see with an MMP system in Canada. If we look at the region of Eastern Ontario, from Ottawa to Kingston and as far west as Belleville, normally we would elect 16 MPs. Under an MMP system, we would also elect 16 MPs, but we would elect 10 local MPs and 6 regional MPs. The local MPs would be divided into 5 single-member ridings in Ottawa, and the rest of the single-member ridings would be spread across the region. Here's what a ballot would look like under MMP for the riding of Ottawa South, part of our Eastern Ontario region. Your first vote helps to elect a local MP to represent your riding the same way you do today. You could vote for a candidate based on local considerations and or party affiliation. You could even support a local candidate who's not with the party you generally support. Your second vote helps to elect the regional MP candidate you prefer. A vote for a candidate for regional MP counts as a vote for that candidate's party. This vote acts to top up the local results so that every vote counts. It's personal and proportional. This simulation is based on results from the 2011 election. Now keep in mind that when you change the voting system, you also change the incentives that affect the kinds of decisions that voters might make. For instance, we know that when every vote counts, voters won't have to worry about splitting the vote or casting a strategic vote. Thus, we should expect that support for different parties might change. Let's say Eastern Ontario voters elect from 10 local ridings, 6 Conservative MPs, 3 Liberal MPs, and 1 New Democrat MP. To apply our MMP model, we use the votes cast in the 2011 election to estimate the popular vote support for the different parties. These estimates in a normal MMP election would come from the second votes that voters marked on their ballots for regional representation. In our MMP model example, in addition to the 10 local members elected, voters would have also elected these 6 MPs from their top-up region. 2 Conservative regional MPs, 1 Liberal regional MP, 2 New Democrat regional MPs, and 1 Green regional MP. By using MMP, the results are a closer match to what voters actually said with their votes. MMP also increases the choices that voters can make. Besides choosing a candidate in their local riding, voters with MMP can choose which candidates amongst the regional MPs they prefer. They can go down the regional list until they see their local candidate or support the party's star candidate, or voters may prefer to support youth or female candidates. The mixed member proportional or MMP voting system provides both local representation and accurate results in terms of the support that voters have given our different political parties. The result is that all MPs have faced the voters and everyone is guaranteed representation equal to their party's share of the votes. Mixed member proportional is one concrete way to create more accurate democratic results in Canadian elections. Is it the right choice for Canada? Make sure to let Fair Vote Canada know what you think. To find out more about MMP, click the links in this video or explore the Fair Vote Canada website. Thank you.
Professor Pulon says it better than I can. Mm-hmm. However, I'll carry on and say a bit more before we go to our candidates. Obviously, proportional representation would mean a lot for Canada. We would not likely have a one-party, one-man government. Parliament would reflect our diverse voters in each province. It would also help a county like Northumberland. We would have competing MPs. Fairvote Canada says rural and urban voters in every region should have fair representation in both government and opposition. Professor Pilon's video showed a region with 16 MPs. That's a good teaching example. The Law Commission said their model was inspired by the models used in Scotland and Wales. Scotland uses regions of 16 MPs, Wales has regions of 12. Now, both the Liberals and the NDP propose the process of 12 months of public consultations to come up with the best model for a new voting system for Canada. For example, regions with 12 MPs means the regional MPs are a little more locally accountable, a little more anchored to real communities. Ontario has 121 MPs elected next month. If Ontario was organized into 10 regions with an average of 12 MPs each, that would still be proportional enough that Green Party voters, on the votes cast in 2011, would have elected 4 MPs just as they deserved. So the size of the regions is a key design feature for public consultations. East of the GTA, we elect 19 MPs. That's too big to be a single region. We don't really want to elect people from Ottawa. Some regions will have fewer than 12 MPs, such as Northern Ontario, which has 9 MPs. So I can see the Ottawa Valley, including Cornwall, with 11 MPs making a good region. That's the bilingual district, 20% French mother tongue. So that leaves 8 MPs elected in our Kingston-Peterborough region, stretching from Lindsay to Brockville. Now in that region, locally in the last election, which elects 8 MPs this year, 219,000 Conservative voters elected 6 MPs, 87,000 Liberal voters elected 1 MP from Kingston, 90,000 NDP voters elected no one, and 18,000 Green voters elected no one. If every vote counted equally, with 8 MPs, those same ballots would elect 4 local Conservative MPs, 1 local Liberal MP, 1 regional Liberal MP, and 2 regional NDP MPs. But, as Professor Pilon just told us, when you change the voting system, you also change the incentives that affect the kinds of decisions that voters might make. For instance, we know that when every vote counts, voters won't have to worry about splitting the vote or casting a strategic vote. Thus, we should expect that support for different parties might change. And when every vote counts, turnout will be higher, perhaps 7% higher. So when voters have more choice, the results will be far more representative of our diverse population and their diverse views. Who can say what would be the result of real democratic elections? One thing we know for sure, it's extremely unlikely that our region's voters would vote exactly as they did in 2011. For example, if the Greens doubled their vote, an extra 16,000 new Green voters would have been enough to elect a Green MP. Now tomorrow, Fair Vote Canada launches our new Where They Stand website. It shows what every candidate running for Parliament across Canada, at least from major parties, has said in response to our questionnaire. More than 50 Liberal candidates have stated their support for proportional representation, and I'm not up to date with the count because we get a few more every day. But I know the last count a few days ago was over 50. And plus there is one lonely Conservative MP from British Columbia who supports it. Now, many other Liberal candidates, in fairness, are still undecided and say so. A few Liberals don't like proportional representation. They prefer instead another winner-take-all system, the preferential ballot in single-member ridings. A study on the last election in the UK a few months ago showed that the preferential ballot would have given the Conservatives an even bigger false majority than the one they did get. In other words, it would be even more skewed than first past the post. But a few Liberals, to be blunt, dream of being everyone's second choice. They think a preferential ballot would give them a partisan advantage. Luckily, from what I can tell, the majority of Liberal activists realize that electoral reform cannot succeed as a partisan project, and they are open to a proportional representation system, which indeed is the official party position. As Stéphane Dion keeps saying, quote, "I do not see why we should maintain a voting system that makes our major parties appear less national and our regions more politically opposed than they really are." Preferential voting, Dion says, does nothing to correct the distortion between votes and seats and the underrepresentation of national parties compared to regional ones. For example, Metropolitan Montreal elects 35 MPs, not one Conservative. In 2011, its 209,000 Conservative voters elected no one. With proportional representation, they would have elected 4 MPs. Canada's second largest city would have been represented in the governing caucus and in cabinet. The 4 MPs would have been the 4 Conservative regional candidates who got the most support from regional Conservative voters. So, last December 3rd, in the House of Commons, the NDP moved a motion. I'll read it. That, in the opinion of the House, A, the next federal election should be the last conducted under the current first-past-the-post electoral system, which has repeatedly delivered a majority of seats to parties supported by a minority of voters, nor under any other winner-take-all electoral system, and B, a form of mixed-member proportional representation would be the best electoral system for Canada. Of the 31 Liberal MPs present, 16 voted yes, 15 voted no. And by the way, although Stéphane Dion has his own personal preferred model, he was one of the 16 that voted for MMP, even though it isn't his first preference. So I give him credit for that. Six others voted for the NDP motion, five MPs from the Greens, Bloc, and the New Strength and Democracy Party, plus even, and this was a surprise to some, Brent Rathgaber, the independent former Conservative. See, some people assume that PR would make MPs less independent. But Toronto MP Craig Scott loves to explain that it's really the opposite. With two votes, you can vote for the party you want in government, and you can also vote for the local candidate you like best, regardless of party, without hurting your party, since it's the second regional ballot that determines the party makeup of the House of Commons. In New Zealand, with a similar system, about 32% of voters split their ballots in that way. This makes it easier, Craig Scott explains, for local MPs to get the support of people of all political stripes. They can earn support for their constituency representation credentials, not just for their party. This boosts the kind of support those MPs bring with them into the House of Commons, thus strengthening their independence. So I'll just mention turnout. In the last election across Canada, the voter turnout was a pitiful 61%. Locally, not much better, 63.7. That compares with 75% back in 1988, what we used to have. And the turnout's typical of countries with normal proportional systems, around 80%. Sweden, last election, 86%. Denmark, 86%. Brazil, 81%. Norway, 78%. Argentina, 77%. New Zealand, 77%. Netherlands, 75%. Austria, 75%. So, that's enough from me. The panelists will now discuss, or at least we've asked them to discuss, three questions. The questions are, number one, do you feel the number of MPs elected from Parliament from each party should be roughly proportional to the number of votes cast for that party's candidates?
That's a short discussion.
That's it, yes. We all just say yes.
Yes.
And that's where the MP from North Vancouver actually agrees with you. Wonderful. Question two, can a model of proportional representation for Canada respect the need for all MPs to face the voters and be accountable to voters? And number three, if an all-party citizen process, which both the NDP and Liberals propose, as a process, if that process recommends adding an element of proportionality to Canada's electoral system, would you vote in favor of implementing those recommendations in time for the following federal election, which should be in 2019? So we drew straws. We drew straws as to numbers, as to what order they would go in.
Thank you. I'd like to thank all of you for coming here tonight. This is the best attendance at one of these Fair Vote events that I've ever seen. And I want to congratulate Wilf. Wilf is a local hero because he's been pushing this idea for so many years. I'm sure all of you know that. And it is probably the single, together with abolishing the Senate, it is the single most important reform that we can make to our democratic system. Bar none. That's just the truth. That's the way it is. If we want young people to vote, if we want people who are disenfranchised, First Nations communities, new immigrants to this country who are now citizens, if we want people to vote, their vote has to count. It has to mean something to them. Hopefully they're going to recognize which of the political parties or local candidates or maybe the leader that they identify with, the values that matter to them. And then when they vote according to that, it's actually going to make a difference. Because right now, the system is so stacked against those people that have a different choice. And I think that's the single most important aspect of fair vote or proportional representation, which is that every vote counts. And that's the most important thing, because that will increase the voter turnout. It will increase engagement. It will increase cooperation. I work a lot with cooperative businesses. I've done that for 30 years. I've helped start over 180 cooperative businesses. And the reason I work in that sector is because it's democratic. That's why I like it. And they make better decisions. The survival rate of cooperatives is twice as good as regular businesses because they're democratic. That's the fundamental reason. And in our society, we hold this idea of democracy so high, and yet we don't actually follow it in reality. So this is such an important meeting tonight. I'm so glad that you've come here tonight. You know where I stand. The NDP has held this position on proportional representation for 30 years. It's been in our policy book. And I think this year it's actually going to happen. The feeling I have is that Canadians are ready to take this next step to a more democratic system. I think the Liberal Party, although they haven't endorsed the idea of mixed member proportional representation, I think they're open to it, really for the first time, to be honest, and Wilf told you some of those numbers. And the Green Party supports it fully, which is wonderful. And the only person that's absent tonight is the Conservative. Is the Conservative Party representative, Adam Moulton, the local candidate. And
we did invite him.
Yes, he was invited. I know that in the past, Rick Norlock usually sent a representative. Rick often talked about personally liking the idea, but to be honest, he never did anything about it. So this is our opportunity, people, to make this change, to improve our democracy, and not just for the next election, but for generations to come. And we need to face some of the most important transgenerational issues that this country's ever faced. Climate change. We can't leave that to the next generations to deal with. It's like a huge burden. We have to deal with it now. Inequality of wealth. That is a growing issue. I've been talking about, this is my fifth election. When Jack Layton decided to run for the leadership of the NDP, I decided to throw my hat in the ring. I worked with Jack in Toronto when I lived in Toronto. And we've been talking about these issues every single election. And I think people are learning, and that's great. And if we can get young people to get out and vote, the NDP will win this election, because anyone between 18 and 34, most of them vote NDP. Educated people, vote NDP. University graduates, vote NDP. So we need to educate each other, people of all backgrounds and income levels, and that's what the point of this session is tonight. And so I hope when you finish tonight, I'm certainly going to hang around if anyone wants to talk to me. I'll be here until the last person that wants to talk to me, I'll be here. But I hope you go home and talk to your neighbors, your friends, your family, and talk to them about this and educate them about it. It's really important. So I have a nephew in Alberta. I'm from Alberta originally. And my nephew has never voted. And he's 32 years old. And so last time I was out in Alberta, I sort of took him. He's a big guy. He's bigger than me. I sort of took him by the shoulders. I am his uncle, right? So I took him by the shoulders and said, why aren't you voting? He said, well, it doesn't make any difference. Why would I bother? And I said, okay. So what if the next election was voting whether or not you could vote again in the future? Would you vote then? Well, yeah, of course I'd vote then. Well, that's what every election is. Thank you.
Thank you, Russ. And before I ask him to speak, I want to be fair to the Conservatives. Yes, we did invite Adam Moulton, and he declined to come, and we invited him to send a representative to bring greetings, as Rick Norlock was in the habit of doing. But he didn't apparently do that unless somebody's lurking. And
are there any Conservatives here? Hold your hand up. Not one? Thinking of voting Conservative?
No. This is a non-partisan event. But I do want to confirm that when our chapter executive sat down with Rick Norlock a year and a half ago for our interview with him, he said that he still supported proportional representation. You know, when the Reform Party was formed, they had a lot of supporters of proportional representation in the Reform Party. And he was active as a supporter of PR. And as Russ said, he's been a quiet supporter in recent years. But he told us a year and a half ago that the Conservative Party has no, this was what he said at the time, had no policy against PR, so he was free to advocate for it. But he said, in all honesty, I don't say much about that in caucus. Mm. So we've got this one Conservative MP from North Vancouver that's come out of the closet this week. But there's a bunch more quiet PR supporters, like Rick Norlock in the Conservative caucus, so it really does have multi-partisan support. Tim.
Okay, after all of that.
Yeah.
Okay. A couple of things. I was saying to Russ out in the hall, I think last year when we did this, we might have had 8 or 10 people at this event. And we've been coming and doing this every year for a number of years. So I can't tell you how excited I am. Not just because this is an important issue, but because this shows that yes, while this election is 11 weeks long, people are engaged, they're paying attention, and I think that is going to be the most important thing as we go through the next 36 or so days. I'm not really sure how many left. So, Wilf has been probably one of my best professors in terms of proportional representation. As you know, he's very passionate about it, but he's also probably the most knowledgeable person I've ever met on the subject, and I have quizzed him and challenged him on a few things, and the result has been certainly I have a deeper knowledge of what's involved, and I think Wilf also knows that I signed the declaration for fair vote, but I also did the questionnaire because I thought it was important to put out in writing what some of the what my position was. In terms of the Liberal Party of Canada, about a year and a bit ago, and I'm not going to say what the exact date is because I don't remember.
January or February.
Thank you. See, I told you. We, as a Liberal Party, made a commitment, Justin Trudeau made a commitment, that one of the first things that we would do as government would be to convene an all-party committee. And by all-party, that doesn't just mean the three main parties. It includes the Green Party, and I'm assuming an independent. I don't know that for sure, but I know it includes the four parties, recognized parties. That's important, because no matter how important we in this room believe it is, if we are going to have something truly vetted by Canadians, we need to all take ownership for it. At the end of the day, it can't be the government in power that puts it forward or stacks the deck, as we see sometimes. It has to be genuinely everyone. And we have said it's all on the table. To Will's point, there are some that agree with proportional representation, and for the ones I have spoken to that did not vote for it, it's not that they don't agree with it. They don't understand it. And it is complicated. I mean, I've been on this for 6 years or so, and while I think I have a handle on it, I'm sure there's one other variation on the theme that I'm not, or maybe 10.
Show them the video.
Show them the video. Well, the video's good, absolutely. The video wasn't out until recently, I guess.
That is correct.
Right, so before the video with the nice little stick man, it was much more complicated. So I don't think that my conversations with them is they're not against it, they don't completely understand it. We've also said that everything is on the table. Proportional representation is an option, the ranked ballot, as you mentioned, online voting. You know, what does that look like? Is that something we should be talking about? If we're going to make a change, then let's talk about what all the possible change are. And we've also stated that mandatory voting, like they have in Australia, we should be talking about that. So the idea is it will be a multi-party committee that will consult with Canadians on all of these ideas and what other ideas Canadians bring forward. And within 18 months of that process starting, we will put forward legislation from that committee to Parliament for passing. So that's our commitment. I've not heard anyone that isn't excited about the process of turning this on its head, because it's not just about whether, you know, 34% of the vote got a majority government. It's about the engagement people have, that people to Russ's comment about his nephew, you know, we've knocked on about 35,000 doors so far. When people tell me they don't vote, I can't tell you how frustrating that is. And my hope is that with this new enthusiasm around a vote counting more, that people will be engaged. The caveat I personally have, and I've shared this with Will, is that because it is complicated, that we make sure that we take very seriously the importance of educating people about how to vote, about how this system works. We don't want, you saw the ballot. You don't want someone walking into the voters booth and saying, oh, I don't know here. Right? So we have a responsibility to follow it through to the education about the voting process as well. So I'm firmly behind it. I am one of those people who do support it, and I'm looking forward to what the outcome will be in 18 months from October 20th. So thank you very much for your time, and I'll be here as well if anybody wants to ask me questions or chat afterwards. This is all about the voting and the nonpartisan, so I'm not going to get into politics, but I'm here. Always love to talk politics, so I'm happy.
Surprise.
And we will have questions from the audience and discussion on the panelists, but
yep.
First.
We didn't applaud.
Patricia Sinnott is the Green Party candidate.
Yes. And September 9th, Elizabeth May launched the Green Party platform. If you haven't seen it, by all means, go to greenparty.ca. I'm very proud of the platform that's come forward from the Green Party. And electoral reform is a very important subject on that platform. And the first step in reforming how we vote is to strike an all-party committee and begin public consultations to develop a model of proportional representation. So I think what you have here is three candidates who think alike on this particular topic. We all agree that this is what we need to do first. So there's no disagreement whatsoever. And I think there are many benefits, as my competitors? Colleagues.
I like that word. There we are.
As Russ and Kim have outlined, to moving towards a proportional representation model of voting, we're going to get people more interested in voting, more excited about voting. They will see results from their efforts to get involved, learn about candidates, and actually vote. It will benefit young people, get them involved. It will benefit women and get women involved, and I really hope it's going to bring more women into politics. That's something we really need in this country. Moving towards this model of voting. And as I say, that's only the first step in making politicians more accountable, Parliament more accessible. We need a voting system that is more representative of the constituents. And the Green Party believes that MPs who are green always act on behalf of their constituents. They're not voting on party lines, there's no party whip. They are voting to represent the people who elected them to office. So I think that's an important feature of the Green Party too. Now, I'm not going to take much more of your time, but thank you very much for coming tonight. I've been involved with Fair Vote Canada for probably about 5 years. I've seen this video several times, and I think that's the best way to learn, is to look at it and then look at it again and go to fairvote.ca and look at it. The first time around, it's kind of, oh my goodness. And as you said, Kim, looking at that complicated ballot is a little overwhelming. But the more you look at it, the more you think about it, the more sense it makes. So again, thank you all for coming, and I'll be here for questions.
Thank you. Anyone who wants to watch that video, I'll tell you how to find it. First of all, you go to fairvote.ca, basic website. On the front page, you will find a little box in the top right-hand corner saying, what is proportional representation? Click on that box. And you'll then get a page that says, here are three examples of how proportional representation could work. Click on the video and you can see the video, you can see the three videos. And the first one is the Law Commission model. The second one is a moderate version of the Law Commission model. And the third one is Stéphane Dion's P3 system. So if you want to see that video, that's how you find it. So, questions and comments, go ahead.
I have a couple comments I'd like to make listening to Kim and Patricia. Number one, I don't find it complicated at all, to be honest. I think it's quite simple and straightforward. And I don't think we need to put smoke screens in front of it. Because the reality is, you have two votes. You vote for your local candidate, just like you do right now. And you vote for a regional candidate. And that was, however you decide, however you make your choice around that, that's up to you. But it's very simple and straightforward. And the most simple and straightforward thing about it is every vote counts. How more simple can you get than that? Versus what we have now, strategic voting, switching your vote, you know, trying to decide, oh my God, like, well, I'm gonna stay home and sit in my hands this time. I'm not gonna use my ballot. Like, all these ridiculous strategies that people are forced into using because we have a flawed system. It's broken. We need to fix it. So I don't agree with Kim. I don't think it's complicated at all. I think it's quite straightforward. Now, the NDP has a very clear proposition on the table. We want to use this system in the video. That's our proposition. Craig Scott has spent 2 years crisscrossing the country, talking to citizens all over the country, and educating people about it. And we've come to that conclusion. That's what the NDP is putting on the table. That's what we'd like to see happen. Now, we don't want to just open it up to some hodgepodge of like 50 different ideas and, you know, what are we going to narrow down to and some combination of this and that. The most important thing that we can do is get a system where every vote counts. Should I say that again? Because, I mean, that's really what it's about. And that is going to encourage all the things Patricia was talking about. It's going to encourage more women to get involved. We need more women in politics. It's kind of a cutthroat competitive business right now. Some call it a blood sport. You know, and if you look at the performance in the House of Commons, I mean, it's pitiful. And by encouraging more collaboration, compromise, what about that old saying that politics is the art of compromise? What happened to that? Right? And cooperation, that's what we can get. And so what that means to me, as a prairie pragmatist, I grew up in the prairies, the best ideas are going to get implemented. I don't care what party they're from. We have good ideas for the people of Canada. Let's get those ideas happening. That's what happened with the minority government in the 60s when Lester Pearson was the prime minister. Tommy Douglas was in the opposition, just came from Saskatchewan. We got public health care. We got unemployment insurance. We got Canada Pension Plan. We got all those things because they were great ideas for people and people liked them. And guess what? They still like them. And we are going to improve those things. And the way we can improve those things is by having a real democracy where all the people at the table are working for the citizens of Canada. Not their special interests or their business buddy or I'm going to get a sweet job on that board of directors when I leave politics or whatever. For the people of Canada, that's why I'm in this. So if that's partisan, so be it. But that's why I want you to vote for me. Because that's what I'm about. It's about democracy.
And now let's ask a question by Kim.
Just a quick response, because it's a passion. I get that. I think Canadians have had enough of being told what things should look like. And I guess that's why I'm excited about putting all the options on the table. And I trust Canadians to be able to sit there and make decisions for themselves about what they think is the best way. Not to say that there won't be experts and academics and people who do this kind of thing that will inform the process. But I don't believe we should be sitting there and saying, we, you know, as you're doing, Russ, You believe proportional representation...
Kim, we do it for everything else. We do it for tax policy, we do it for immigration policy, we do it for everything else. I mean, what we're saying is we've been holding this idea for 30 years, and every other democracy has...
I wasn't quite finished. I believe that is part of what the problem is that we've been having over the past 10 years. Things have been done unilaterally. And I want the consultation with Canadians. I think at the end of the day, look at this crowd here compared to 8 or 10 people last year. Canadians want it. So they're going to work towards it. And I don't believe I certainly have the expertise to be able to say this or that. But I believe there are people out there, and there are. Canadians should have a voice. And at the end of the day, to your point about Pearson and Tommy Douglas and all of the good things we got from minority governments, it's because nobody had a hammer. Everybody sat down around the table and put their 3 cents in, and they came up with the best solution. And I think that's the way to go.
Okay. One thing I want to say about consultation, and then we'll go to questions. The Law Commission, when they came up with that model, they took a year to do it, and they held 16 public consultations across Canada. So there's no doubt, to design a system like that, you have to have consultations. Okay, questions.
Yeah, I did have a question. Both you and Russ mentioned at the beginning, in your opening comments, that both the NDP and the Liberals were going to have consultations. But I know that part of the platform of the NDP, correct me if I'm wrong, because you're both NDP, is that that you guys have selected a mixed member proportion. And like tonight, like for instance, you showed a video on mixed member proportional, but you mentioned also that you had two other videos on two other different models that you could have brought here for the benefit of all the crowd. But, and you mentioned in your opening comments about consultations, but your party's policy is that you've already decided on mixed member proportional, which I don't mind in a sense, because I think it's a pretty good model. It's a model I understand. But I just wonder if you could clarify, because that's what you said on your opening consultation.
Yeah, and we do have a clear proposition on the table. It's in our platform. It's been in our policy for 30 years that we want a proportional representation system. And this particular system is the one that we feel, that we've studied, that we're looking at together with the Law Commission, etc., that we feel other countries are using,
sure,
if they have a track record,
yeah,
right? Yeah,
so is there going to be consultation?
Okay,
yes.
Can I comment on that? Because I've been talking to Craig Scott about it.
Who's Craig Scott?
NDP,
sure.
Democratic Reform critic.
Okay.
Lead man on the whole,
sure,
project. And if you go to that website, the second model you click on talks about the Jenkins Commission MMP model, which is based on the report of the Jenkins Commission in the UK that proposed an MMP model which has a couple of interesting differences. First of all, the regions are only 8 MPs on average, which makes it a little harder for small parties to win seats. It's designed to be a more moderate model. And the second thing about it is that it uses the preferential ballot for local MP. And the NDP has not ruled out either of those points. It could be regions as small as 8 MPs or as large as 16 or anywhere in between. And that makes a big difference to smaller parties. And it could be a preferential ballot for local MP. The NDP hasn't ruled that out either. So those two MMP models on the Hero Canada website, they are both within the scope of things that the NDP plans to consult on.
It wasn't clear to me from the video what the proportion was based on. Like, you vote for a local MP, and that just elects the local MP, and then those votes don't count anymore.
That's correct.
And then just the votes for the regional thing, that establishes the percent, like, you know, 50% one party, 30% another party, 20% another.
Yeah, right,
and
on then, the ballot, right on that ballot that we showed you there, it says, a vote for your regional candidate counts as a vote for the party.
Yeah.
And puts that right on the ballot.
Okay.
So it's clear that's how it works. You're right.
So, but I'm saying the proportion is just based on those votes, not on the votes for the local.
That's right. That tops it up.
Yeah. And then you're going to have to top up to match these percentages.
That is correct.
Yeah. So theoretically, like, you could have the people elect, like, all conservative. So they could vote all conservative MPs, local MPs, and then would you have enough to really balance up? Like, what happens if the other ones voted 100%, you know, liberal or something? Then you can't balance up. There's not enough there to balance
up. You're ready to take Dennis Bielam's master's program. You're good. that is one of the key design questions when designing an MMP system, is what is the ratio of local to regional MPs? In Germany, it's half and half, 50-50. And in Scotland, it's 44% regional. And in Wales, it's only 33% regional. And the model that we were looking at there is about 37% regional. But that's one of the questions, is if you have more regional MPs, like take those eight MPs from Lindsay to Barkville that I mentioned. Mm-hmm. If it was like Germany, it would be four local MPs and four regional MPs. So instead of eight MPs, you'd have four, the ridings are twice as big. So the more proportional you make it, the larger the local ridings are. And that's a trade-off when you're designing an MMP system. Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
But, well, how you split from regional to the proportional MPs, that's something to be decided during the consultation that's going to take place when the new Parliament strikes the all-party committee and goes out for public consultation.
Yep, that's one of the key design questions.
Yes. So there's going to be discussion and opportunity for various decisions to
and
be
you're
made.
Getting ready for it because you want to hear all about it.
And that's great. So I hope you'll come out next year.
I'll bring my spreadsheet.
Yes. That's absolutely right. Anyone else have a question? Yes.
So I'm a bit of a skeptical voter. I'll confess that at the start. The way I see it is the Conservatives don't want electoral reform. The Greens have been on record as supporting it forever. So the Liberals and the Conservatives, those are the ones that I'm wondering about, because there's this phenomenon I've noticed where if you benefit from first-past-the-post, you start to feel in favor of first-past-the-post. So if you get elected through first-past-the-post, your view starts to shift, and I'm worried about that. So if the NDP and the Liberals together form the government, now they've been elected by first past the post. Is that going to change their view? That's my worry.
It's in the platform.
It's in the platform, but I'll give you an example of where you're dead on. When Dalton McGuinty got elected as Prime Minister of Ontario,
Premier,
in 2003, the Liberals had spent the previous 45 years, most of the time, other than 5 years out of the previous 43, sitting in opposition, facing a Conservative government with a false majority. So when they got elected in 2003, they knew why they needed PR. Unfortunately, the phenomenon took root that you're just describing, that after they've been sitting there for 3 years, they've lost their enthusiasm for PR, and they've wondered, why did we want that again? And one of the solutions to that is to jump right into it. Jean Charest, in 2004, was elected Premier of Quebec in an election in which all three major Quebec parties pledged support for proportional representation. So he jumped right into it, right away, started the process, appointed a minister, started the consultations. But then it came time to design the model. The design went into his caucus, and his caucus debated it for 12 months and polluted it. And when it came out, it was a very poor system, and it got public rejection, and it went back to the drawing boards, and it died. That's the phenomenon that has been happening for a long time. René Lévesque got elected in his second election in 1980, having lost his referendum. He got re-elected and he said, okay, well, we lost the referendum, now we're going to fix democracy. And he was a strong supporter of PR, and the Parti Québec platform supported it. So he brought in legislation, draft legislation, and set up a minister and started the process. And when it got halfway through, the majority of his backbenchers said, what will happen to my seat? And they deep-sixed it. And that was very disappointing to him. And in fact, he resigned before the next election. He never did fight another election after winning in 1980. He was disillusioned. And it wasn't just over PR, but that was an example of how things were not, he was not getting things his way. And he was a real democratic reformer. So even the best democratic reformer in Canada, and you may not like René Lévesque for some of his things, but he was a great democratic reformer. He brought in controls on election finance. He was way ahead of his time on a whole lot of democratic reforms. And even the best democratic reformer in Canada couldn't get it through his own caucus. So, yes.
So we'll
hold their feet to the fire. Hold their feet to the fire and make sure they fulfill the platform. Absolutely.
How did the NDP and the Liberal candidate respond to this question?
Okay.
Well, I think the NDP is pretty clear that, you know, we've held the position that we support proportional representation for 30 years. We've done public consultations. We will continue with public consultations. It's not a hammer, as Kim said. There's no hammer involved. It's a consultation. And we need to make a decision together as Canadians about how we want to reform it. And, you know, obviously the NDP will put on the table what it would like to see happen, and we'll get feedback from people, including the other parties, and the Conservatives are welcome to be a part of that if they want to. It's their choice. We're not going to force them to, but if they want to, they can be part of it. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I mean, for me personally, I will put it on the table right now. I would do the same thing René Lévesque did. I would resign, because I'm not going to, you know, if the NDP steps back from that policy, I would be bitterly disappointed. So I would resign as the MP if I was elected. That's what I would do. And I would fight hard and, you know, be the best, most effective politician I could be to get this system in place.
Would you also resign, MP?
Would I resign?
If proportional representation was deep-sixed, as it has been done numerous times, even though the Liberal Party supports...
Well, you know, I'd have to ask the question what deep-six means, because if, to your point, if we have a minority government, and the consultation panel, if you will, is made up of MPs from every single party, and that was why it was written in the platform exactly that way. So no party has the ability to deep six it. The recommendation that we have said, we have a timeline on ours, and we have said that we will put forward legislation within 18 months. So I'm not going to grandstand here and say, oh, I'll quit if something happens or doesn't happen. I'm saying if you have every single party around the table, and that table says this is what we're putting forward based on everything we've heard from Canadians, we think this is the best way, and it goes to Parliament, I will do my job and vote for it. But I can't control what, if it's a minority, especially if it's a minority government, where all those votes lie. So I will do my part, but I believe that the key to this working is making it an even playing field, if you will, on that committee for every party.
I want a point of clarification. My point of clarification is, if the NDP backtracked on their policy, that's when I'd resign. I can't control a minority government.
If it was a majority government.
A majority, or if they, for whatever reasons, you know, decided that they're going to back away from some kind of proportional representation, then I would want to be part of that.
Okay, more questions.
But in the minority parliament, which is what I expect we will have on October the 20th, we're going to have at least a dozen Green MPs who are then going to be holding the balance of power. So I would like to remind you, you've seen how effective Elizabeth May has been in the past 4 years. So just remember, she will be there. She will bring people together. She will help people to consult. She knows how to collaborate. She knows how to work across party lines. She will ensure that everyone else does the same thing, because proportional representation is something we really need to do for all Canadians. Thanks.
Okay, questions? Yes.
Yep. Thank you. I understand and support the proportional representation
However, I think that we do have a problem today, and that is that in the first past the post system, we do have winners who get less than 40% of the vote. And I think that an election is much more about getting a legitimate representation in the House by a legitimate representative as opposed to just simply winning a race. And for us as a society, in switching from the first past the post style voting to proportional representation, I think what is easy to understand is that our man or woman from our region is truly someone that we accept as our representative. So in this two ballot system, I think it would be extremely important to still have the preferential ballot system, for example, to establish who my local riding rep is going to be. And then IPAR allows some other massaging system should be introduced to get the proportions correct. Okay. And I was a little disappointed in this presentation because it missed that fundamental point.
Well, it's in there. If you go to the Fair Uganda website, click on what is the portion representation, go to the page with the three videos. No. You want the second video.
Thank you.
And that's the one that has your mind. So we are proposing that people look at more than one model. And there it is.
Thank you.
Yes, at the back.
What I do know from this, from what I've gathered from this, there's a candidate missing tonight, and under proportional representation, I think he'd be here. Could be, or we wouldn't be able to elect a regional. To not be here or to not be at any of these events doesn't fit into that idea of proportional representation. So I don't see why we wouldn't want it, because someone thinks they cannot be here and it's okay.
Good point.
I just wondered why we didn't get to see all three models tonight, that there was only just the one presented to us.
Well, I could have shown all three. I wanted to hear from the candidates too.
Yeah, it just means it almost turns out that the way the evening has gone is that a choice has been made for us already.
No, so,
like, out of the three, you chose to do this one, perhaps because you liked it the best, but that isn't necessarily an opportunity for the audience to have a better view of the various models that are out there.
Well, I hear you, but as I said, we didn't want to make the evening too long, and we wanted to hear from the candidates, so that's what we did.
And
but
you can go
and look at the other two on the website.
Well, there's another meeting, so we should hear from them.
Yes.
Yes.
Jordan,
I saw your
name. Yes, speaking of minority governments, if you believe the current opinion polls, we're probably going to have a minority government after the results of this election. Mm-hmm. I think all three of you, and I think all three of your parties, are in favor of this election being the last one conducted under first past the post.
Yes.
But because we may have a minority, it's possible that we could have another election in a year or two, and it's possible we may not get to enact the changes in order to have a different system to vote under.
Yeah.
So what would you and your parties do if that were the case?
I don't think, I'll answer as best I can. I don't think we'd have a choice. It's what happens in minority governments. It's usually about 18 months or so, sometimes less, sometimes a little more. There is a process within Parliament that has to take place, and I don't think that there would be any way if let's say 16 months from October 20th, the red is dropped again. I don't think you could possibly get that through, just given the legislative calendar and how things, and don't forget, there's a lot of things we have to fix over the next bit, so we're not talking about that tonight. But
and also, even if you pass it in 18 months,
still has to go.
The mechanism, it's
going to
take at least
correct.
A year or two to get
it going.
Yeah.
So I think it depends on the kind of minority it might be. Like, I have no idea what the result of the election is going to be. I don't think anybody does, to be honest. But if we have a minority government where if the Liberals and the NDP and the Greens can get together and sign an agreement and have a coalition, which is completely legitimate under our parliamentary system. And we put this on the table and try to make this work and do the consultations with the public, etc. I don't see why we can't, you know, move that forward. I mean, we've moved, public health care was a huge deal. The doctors went on strike. And we still have it. So I think we can do it. If there's a will, there's a way. And I think by working together, this is something that we can make happen. I mean, that's the art of politics.
I'm just going to make one comment on that before we get to the question over there. Thank you for pointing that out.
I'm just trying to drag that.
Yep. There have been minority parliaments that have run for 4 years. Manitoba had one. And there have been coalition governments at the provincial level. There was one in BC that ran for years, and there was one in Saskatchewan. I think it's going to be very important on October 20th to put forward a stable government for Canada for the next 4 years. Otherwise, we're going to prove Stephen Harper right that if you either have a strong, stable, conservative majority government or you have chaos. And I don't want to prove him right. So I hope that we don't have something that fiddles along for 18 months and gets another red drop. I think that's the last thing Canada needs.
I agree.
Okay.
Yes, I agree.
I think that we do ourselves a disservice if we trivialize the complexity of proposing a new voting system. Because I, in my career path, deal with a wide range and a varied age group of people, everyone from entry-level adults, people can be my clients from the time they are of voting age and not before, right up to people in a nursing home. And I would have to say that about 30% of them, irrespective of wealth, irrespective of education, irrespective of career, do not have an email address because they do not own a personal computer. So what would you propose to do to educate these people, a vital component of the voting population in this? Because I think you do yourself a disservice by trivializing the complexity of it, but not only that, I think you run the risk of alienating people who would perhaps be reluctant to query if they've been told that it's simple. This is a fairly educated little corner over here. We're both thinking, who knows, man?
I'm saying, from my point of view.
No, I understand that, because of course you can only speak from your own point of view.
No, but it's straightforward in terms of every vote counting. The mechanisms may be a little more complicated, and there's these percentages and regional votes, and you know, how are you going to figure out the mechanism? And it's not likely to be a final system. It'll get tweaked and changed over time, right? But the fundamental concept is straightforward and simple. So in terms of educating people, I think that's vitally important. And I think that's something that, you know, the provinces, when they did it, BC and Ontario, for example, there was no serious education effort. I mean, I got one pamphlet.
Have there been any thought about how you would put the concept forward to historic voters, new voters? New voters are going to be the easiest time to turn because they've never voted before. It's all going to be new to them.
But is that something Fair Vote Canada has considered? How else to reach out to people besides meetings like this and the website? What about the people who are not on the internet, Wolf?
Yes, and one of the things that Elections Canada used to do before it got its wings was education, and they were very good at that. And they ran some great education programs, and they ran some great youth education programs.
So that's a good question.
Yes, I think Elections Canada could do the job. I really do.
So that's a good question to the candidates. Will your parties support a re-strengthening of of that organization, you know,
yes.
that was cut back so
yes.
much.
And bringing back that education yes. function.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. Elections Canada has had a significant reduction, as have so many of the departments and the ministries, mm-hmm. and it's something we have clearly said. They have a, it's not just, to Tracy's point, it's not just about putting in a new system that will be more democratic and all those things that we know it can be and should be. It's about having it functioning. Mm-hmm. And the only way it functions in the way we want it to is if everybody votes. Mm-hmm. So it is an education piece, and it will be incumbent upon us to make sure Elections Canada has the resources to make sure it happens.
Well, interesting.
Okay, question in the back here.
You need to set up a program and take it around to people just like you're doing tonight.
Yeah.
To educate.
New job.
You're retired, you have time on your hands.
Much.
Take it into the nursing homes.
Yeah.
Did you ask?
Exactly.
No. I saw you asking a question. No. All right. I'll get somebody who hasn't asked. Anyone who hasn't asked a question yet? Yes.
Could I get your comments on the Fair Elections Act?
Well, I called the Unfair Elections Act myself.
Can it be repealed? Can it be?
Yeah, of course.
Can it be amended? Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It would be
automatic. As I'm at Elections Canada office and trying to, they have a nice Aussie brochure, a handout, about what ID you need to vote. Then I was at a retirement residence today, and people were saying, oh, but my driver's license expired, and but I don't have this, and but I don't have that, and my daughter pays all my bills, so I don't get anything here. And so it's all of those questions. So, and it's not unlike what we're talking with proportional representation and changing the way we vote. We're changing the way we allow people to vote, and it is an education process as well. So a lot of changes have happened around that, and the Unfair Elections Act, I agree with Russ, that's what I called it as well, has done some serious harm to our democracy. I mean, the whole idea was voter suppression, and frankly, yes. unfortunately, it's working.
Yes, and it's going to suppress votes from students and from First Nations people as well.
Seniors,
low-income
homeless, yeah. and low-income.
And talking about voter suppression, I'll give you guys a good line. First past the post system is the ultimate voter suppression system. It throws half the ballots in the garbage.
Yes. So can we use that, or is that copyrighted?
You can use it.
Go ahead.
I'd just like to make a couple of comments. When we had this election back in Ontario a few years back to change the voting system, and we had inadequate preparation of the public, that's a sure way to buy into failure.
It is.
You will not have any change.
Correct.
And I would tend to agree with Russ that the proportional system of voting that we're talking about, this MMP, is relatively simple in that you have a local riding rep, plus you have a regional. As to what percentage they will represent of the total number of seats, respectively, is a technicality. And I'm not sure if we need to get into that when we come to educate the public. What we need to get into is to make that simple point. There is regional, and then there is local.
If you want to tell people that this is a simple, practical system, just tell them that they use it in Scotland, they've used it for the last 18 years now to elect the Scottish Parliament. They have local MPs, they have regional MPs.
Exactly. Right.
And if there is a more practical people on this planet than the Scots, then I don't know who they are, and they love it.
I agree with you, I'm married to one.
There are three things.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. Just the other thing about responsibility for making these changes, it's also going to change, I won't say change, the candidates are going to have more responsibility. We're talking about, we already have geographically in this riding, this is much bigger geographically than it was last election. Less population, much bigger geographically. So when you're taking the area and making the ridings bigger, you have more responsibility as a candidate to get people to know you and get to, you know, the far reaches, of, if you will, of the riding. And then you have the regional representatives and how they come, whether they come on a list or however they come. They're even bigger geographical ridings for them to get out and meet people and know people. So we sort of have to think about this. It to make sure that the constituents have an opportunity to meet all of these people that they may be able to vote for. It is going to take more work, and it's going to take a lot of time, and it's going to take resources. So we have to think about that too.
It's a common saying in Scotland that their system is good for voters and bad for politicians because it makes the politicians compete with each other and work a lot harder.
Fair. I'd like to make just one last comment, and this is providing that there is a minority government. I would suggest that the minority government or a coalition government make the change to the electoral process as priority number one for that government, because it will be their survival in all sense of the word, because we are talking about establishing democracy. And if you don't, you may miss it for the next 50 years. And I don't think I'm exaggerating.
I don't think you are. I think you're exactly right.
So if the parties that are in this, let's say, coalition for sake of argument, do not have the intestinal fortitude to get on with the job, they don't deserve to be there.
I don't think anybody disagrees.
No,
disagrees.
Question there?
Hi. One thing that Mr. Harper did when he arrived in Thalberg was to cancel the $2 per vote
subsidy
that went to every party, basically. Mm-hmm. Is that something that any of you three parties would bring back? And if yes, how would that work within, a PR system?
I think that was a really good idea. Mm-hmm. And it also, helped smaller parties get their message out, which I think is good for democracy. And it also leveled the playing field, which was important. And what you've seen now with this Unfair Elections Act, parties are allowed to spend $700,000 a day more every day of the election. That's why Mr. Harper decided to make this, a 76-day or 77-day election, because they can spend $25 million more on advertising.
And get 60% back.
Well, it is subsidized by the taxpayer. But from the NDP's point of view, at this point anyway, I'm not aware that it's in the platform to bring back the vote subsidy. I think it's a great idea, personally, and I think it worked really well. And honestly, I think it was one of the best things John Kretchen did when he was in power.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to make one comment in response to that.
I'm not aware of any discussion around that, but I'll ask the question, actually, because I haven't heard anything.
Nor have I, but I agree that would be a good thing to bring back to kind of level the playing field.
Yeah, we have to remember that there is still, for instance, in this riding, and I'm going to get the numbers off by a couple of dollars, but I think last election it was around 95,000 was our limit, and this time it's 223,000. But what we have to remember is in ridings, especially with the Conservatives, they have so much money, they're topping up their candidates in the ridings. And when they file the returns, they will get, I think it's 60%, might be 50%, I'm pretty sure it's 60% return of the money they've spent. So as taxpayers, we're giving, if they spend $200,000, we're giving them 60% back. So taxpayers are not off the hook. And this extended election period, in fact, is costing us, we're hearing closer to $500 million plus dollars just in rebates.
So we don't even want to think about another election in 18 months. That is off. It's off the agenda. People have to work together October 20th. Way to go.
Yes, I just want to make one comment in response to that and then get to your question. The per vote subsidy raises a point that hasn't been discussed yet. How large does a small party have to be before they should be represented? Germany has a 5% threshold, and they've had that ever since the Second World War, and they did that as part of their anti-Nazi reforms to make sure that they couldn't be paralyzed by a bunch of little parties. Sweden has a 4% threshold, which is one of the more common thresholds across Europe. Those are the common thresholds, is 4 or 5%. And one of the most surprising things about Jean Chrétien's voter subsidy, which I agree was a brilliant move, is he did a really radical thing. He gave that to anybody that got 2%. Now, there isn't a country in the world except Israel. There isn't a PR country in the world except Israel that has a threshold as low as 2%. Israel does it for their own reasons because they're so fragmented. But this raises the interesting point about just where that threshold should be. I don't think it should be as low as 2%, but maybe I'm wrong. John Pagan thought 2% was good for vote subsidy. Go ahead. Yes.
Just a quick question. You've mentioned a number of countries that you're modeling this on. Has anybody looked at Switzerland?
Yes.
Well, you did it. Trust me. You never mentioned Switzerland.
Well, Switzerland has a special feature that most PR countries don't have.
It has a lot of special features.
Switzerland and Northern Ireland are the only two places that do this. They have a cabinet that is by law a consensus cabinet that's made up of all parties. Now there could be another one other than Northern Ireland and Switzerland. Those are the only two I know that do that.
But they also bring the public in with their popular initiatives. They can't just blast ahead and say, well, we're doing this. Every single citizen in Switzerland has a say in it. And they can completely toss something out, and this educates, the whole nation is totally educated politically. Whereas here, too many of them aren't even interested enough to find out about what your Fair Vote Canada is. So the education is sadly lacking here, whereas a country like Switzerland is, they do it, it's taught in the schools, it's done so that there is no escape. So they're part of the system all the way. For example, when they wanted to put blue hats on the soldiers, it went for a referendum, and the population had to vote yes on simple things everywhere. And for example, being a Swiss citizen, if something happens to me and I'm totally stone broke here, my canton will take care of me.
Yeah.
So it's a whole system. It's a thought process, not the size of the country or the number of mountains. It's a thought process, and it has
the chocolate.
It has an output that could be very, very beneficial to be looked at right here.
I just want to see. We're getting a couple of people here who've asked more than one question. Is there anybody that's had their hand up that I didn't see? Yes.
Okay. We currently have 308. After this next election, we're voting for 338, right? So an increase of 30. So how many more MPs, how many more salaries, benefits, what's it going to cost to go on this particular system?
Well, I don't know whether you saw the video. In the video, Professor Pilon explained that there would still be 338 Same. MPs under the Law Commission model. So no, there would not need to be any more MPs.
Okay.
And we'd get rid of the Senate, hopefully, so we'd have fewer.
Now, listen, I'm not laying down the law here. I've been accused of that rightly. I mean, I don't want to say that the way it is in that video is the way it's going to be, because there's going to be public consultations. There may be people who will say that we should have more MPs. Because the downside of this system, as you pointed out, Kim, is that the ridings are bigger. So a lot of people have said, wow, just supposing we could abolish the Senate at the same time as we did this, right? So get rid of the 100 senators and add 100 MPs to the House of Commons.
Nice.
Now, that would be lovely. So that's, I'm not ruling that out. Yes.
My question exactly is, how does the Senate figure in this type of House of Commons?
I don't think it does. I mean, it's a separate issue.
Yeah.
Well, but, you know, we all think that too many layers of government is a problem, and this seems to have more checks and balances in it. Do we actually need the Senate? So my question is,
I don't know if the candidates want to deal with that.
Well, I mean, the Senate's in our Constitution, and of course, as you know, there are lots of challenges to address. For people who want to abolish it, it's a long-term project. It's certainly not short and medium-term. So I don't think we should get our sort of be cloudy about this. I think this is important, that the
But it doesn't change the way the government works at all.
No,
it just changes how you get them.
Right, but
so it really doesn't.
But you, I guess I'm saying I don't want people to think, well, if we could do this and this at the same time,
yeah.
Because I don't want this slowed down by another process.
I agree.
Yes. Yes.
The thing is about it that they're both democratic reforms, because the unelected Senate is also unaccountable, apparently. So, and you know, I think sometimes there has been some sober second thought and there have been some good reports, but generally, basically for the whole life of the Senate, that's why the NDP's had the position for 50 years to abolish the Senate. For the whole life of the Senate, it's been filled with, you know, partisan appointees and bagmen.
Now, I said it was an unrelated issue, but I'll take that back because I can see one connection. People think of the Senate as possibly having some useful value as a sober second thought.
Mm-hmm.
But if you had a House of Commons elected by PR, so that every vote counts, you're not going to have 39% of the voters electing somebody who's got 100% of the power. There won't be as much need for the Senate. So once you've got a Democratic House of Commons, maybe it'll be easier to abolish the Senate because there'll be less need for it.
Yeah. Well, can I just respond? I'm going to take a little exception with what Russ said. You know, I think of Hugh Siegel. You brought his name up. I know Hugh. I think he was a conservative appointed by a liberal prime minister. He certainly wasn't there as a bag man, or he did some very good work. And there are other people like him. And I think we have to remember that. I think of
Romeo Dallaire.
We have a senator, Jim Munson, who took on the autism file a number of years ago when nobody really knew what autism was. And he has raised the specter and raised money. There are senators who do good work. I don't think the Senate is the issue. I think who we appoint to the Senate is an issue. And the proposal that we have, that it is a nonpartisan body that will interview and vet recommendations for the senators, takes away the partisanship. I don't want senators appointed because there's patronage or because they raise money like Senator Duffy. I don't want that. But I want good people in a place. You know, someone mentioned about what if all the conservatives got all the seats. Well, that is a possibility. You could think that we could have a parliament with 337 conservatives and one green candidate, one green MP. And if you don't have a Senate, you have absolutely no control over what's happening. So if you have a Senate that's not partisan, you don't, because they'll put through legislation with nobody being able to stop it. What you want is a Senate. Just finish. What you want is a Senate that doesn't have partisanship. I'm not saying it's going to be easy to achieve, but I say that has to be our first goal, because abolishing it cannot happen in the short to medium term.
No, no.
And we have to pass legislation, or why are any MPs getting elected?
Well, I don't see it. How do you say it can't be? It takes leadership. I mean, everybody thought Trudeau could never repatriate the Constitution, but he had the leadership, he got the people together, and he did it. The trouble is the current leader doesn't have the guts to stand up. He just took the Supreme Court ruling and ran. Instead of saying, I'm the leader, I'll stand up and I'll see the premiers of the provinces and we'll work at it.
I just want to remind people that this meeting is not about the Senate.
It's sort of got
I know,
more democracy.
I know. I know. But do we have any questions that aren't about the Senate?
I'd like to just make one quick comment. I don't think it serves anyone's purpose, Kim, really, to give examples like if there are 337 conservatives elected, but it's a ridiculous example, because under a proportional representation system, that could never happen. That's not going to happen, because there's actually going to be more diversity of ideas,
exactly.
Not fewer.
Yes, I'm saying on what we have right now, that's possible.
Or what we have now is. I mean, Alberta was a 100% or something.
Just one quick point.
I'm just going to make one comment that if people thought this meeting was going to end at 8:30 as it was advertised, you've got 1 minute for questions. So last minute questions.
I do not have a question. I just want to thank you, Bill. This is a marvelous meeting.
Here, here.
Go ahead.
I do have one question, and I had this theoretical dilemma in my head. How would the Canadian Parliament work? under a proportional representation system where probably not one party would end up with the majority.
Yes.
So it would be a perpetual minority government requiring cooperation, which is against the political heritage of the country. You don't cooperate, you fight. It's a blood sport. How can we make that system function well and have a strong, effective government?
That's a wonderful question. And my answer to it is that human beings, if you study evolutionary psychology, the reason we're so successful as a species is because we cooperate. That is why. So it's natural for us to cooperate. That other system puts an artificial sort of system of competition that is unhealthy and dysfunctional onto a human being that wants to cooperate and work things out with other people. So I think the system itself, the first past the post, as Wilf calls it, winner take all, a zero-sum game, that is a competitive system. But with a coalition, collaborative, more women, everyone's vote counts, new ideas, it's going to be more cooperative. The culture will change.
I'll tell you one thing, and then it is 8:30. 23 years ago, New Zealand adopted the MMP system. A professor had written a book titled Unbridled Power, which described the problems they were having with people getting elected and doing the opposite of what they said they were going to do. It happened in New Zealand too. And the consensus of the public from that book and from all the developments that have been happening is that we don't want to give one man or one party unbridled power. So they voted for MMP knowing that it was probably going to result in coalition governments. And they have had coalition governments in New Zealand for the last 23 years, and they had a referendum 2 years ago on whether to keep their MMP system, and they voted to keep it. So, if you think that all countries with the heritage of the British parliamentary system can't learn to cooperate, there's your counterexample. And I think that's a good book to end. So thank you all for coming.
Thanks, Will.
Thank you.